the Fundy Fringe Festival, uncensored, unjuried, and unbelievably entertaining. The Fundy Fringe runs August 21st to the 25th, with local and visiting performers from all over. Tickets are only $10 a show, and all ticket sales go to the artists. F4 Fringe Power is radio in support of the Fundy Fringe Festival on local 107.3 FM. That's F4. You're listening to Fringe Power. Welcome back, Fringe folks, to the third episode of Fringe Power's sixth season. 6 years of the Fundy Fringe Festival. We're going to get right to our interviews because I need to get home soon and have a nap. These cats I live with are driving me mad. I'm so sleep deprived. You see, the same week I adopted Sally Deadpool 3, my friend got a work opportunity out west and had to move, like you do in St. John. I took in her boy cat, Angus, great guy, known him since he was a kitten, but a beast. Thick. Weighs in at over 20 pounds, and when you look at him in the face, he looks like a ball. Perfect circle. So round you can see his eyes and butt at the same time. I'm not saying he's a fat cat. We sensitive types would use the term food motivated. So, I have good old Angus on a diet, and he's not happy. I swear he's trying to trip me up and kill me. Always yowling into the wee hours of the morning for more food. He won't stop eating. He'll stop eating what I just served him to see what I'm serving Sally Deadpool 3. From no cats to two. Anyway, to the Fringe phone. Our first guest is Veronica Steele from the Wicked Fountain of Youth, performing at the Fundy Fringe August 21st to the 25th. Veronica Steele. That's a great name, Veronica Steele.
It sounds like a writer, doesn't it?
It sounds like a agent, like a secret agent. Like
secret agent. Yeah. I've heard that before, too.
Yeah.
Shh, don't tell anybody.
Like
it's
a cop.
Secret identity.
Yeah, I know. did that affect your life at all, your name? Growing up, Veronica Steele.
Yeah.
I think it's a good name. I think that having a strong, confident name sets the tone. But I was actually like very shy growing up. So I think having a very confident name pushed me outside my comfort zone.
Okay, cool. Yeah, my original name was Headley. So names are important. Veronica and Charlotte from the Wicked Fountain of Youth. So one person show, you're the writer. Is this the first time you're going to be doing it?
No, we actually staged it last October at the London One Act Festival. Where we won Best Original Script and Charlotte won for Best Actress.
Oh, perfect. No, that's exciting.
So we thought this would be a good piece to take on the road to some other stages and see what other people think.
What's the Wicked Fountain of Youth about?
It's about a 17-year-old girl who is trying to come to terms with her mother's alcoholism and how it has affected her life and will continue to affect her life because her mother was an underage drinker at age 18 and got pregnant and continued to drink beer and wine while she was pregnant. So the teenage girl now has fetal alcohol syndrome.
Is this something for all ages?
We're encouraging teenagers to come out. I wouldn't say young children, but if you're 13 and older, I would encourage them to come out. It is a difficult subject matter, and we try to show it with realism, but also try to look for the lighter, funnier moments, because these people have a completely different way of looking at the world than the rest of us do. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, the alcohol affects the prefrontal cortex. So for them, it's like being drunk all the time.
Yeah.
Because as an adult, when we drink, we can metabolize that alcohol so our brain can recover, but a developing baby's brain can't recover. So those effects of being drunk stay with them their whole lives. Like, it's irreversible.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, you know, and we all know what it feels like to be a little tipsy and you're a little bit off balance and you laugh all the time, you don't take anything seriously, and you can't remember where you left your keys, and you can't, you know, and you're maybe overly sexual or your inhibitions are lower, and, you know, all the things that we like about drinking. But for these kids, they cannot escape it. They are always under the influence. Essentially, their brains become permanently like that.
Mm-hmm. Have you had Have you had a lot of good response from people who maybe have had to suffer through this life experience as well? Have you had any feedback from groups like this?
Actually, Charlotte's mother is an addiction counselor at Portage, and they're going to have us do the show, two private showings at the Portage, where clinicians and social workers will be in attendance, because it is essentially a case study of how does a teenager transition to adulthood? What does coming of age look like for someone who has this kind of disability?
Okay, well, congratulations
on
that.
Yeah, but you know, it is kind of a subject matter nobody talks about. Yeah. I mean, we all know you shouldn't drink while you're pregnant, but nobody really realizes why. You know, and nobody really realizes where all do these kids come from with the behavioral problems and, you know, those special kids that, you know, people just think, oh, they just were born wrong, and nobody really thinks twice about it, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. What brought you to write this piece?
I had a really bad cold one day, and I took some Sudafed in the morning, and I was actually trying to write a film script, because I'm a screenplay writer as well, and I had booked, you know, Thursday morning is the day I'm going to sit down and do some work on the script, and I had this really bad cold. I took some Sudafed, which didn't help, and then around lunchtime, I think I switched to Benadryl, and I didn't know that it was, like, not the same thing, and then I started feeling, like, really spaced out, and my brain was not functioning, and I thought, well, in a couple of hours, I'll feel better. But imagine if you never feel better. What if you're spaced out and weird and all the time, and you're trying to get anything done? And my husband's daughter has fetal alcohol syndrome. So she kind of inspired me. Like, I was thinking, this must be what Tasha feels like all the time. Like, just off and, like, unbalanced and in a fog and unclear about things, and you know how hard that must be. Mm-hmm. So I couldn't write what I was working on, so I opened a new blank document and started writing about, you know, what does the world seem like if you're drunk all the time?
Mm-hmm.
You know, what does the world seem like when you're in a fog all the time, or you only really notice what's right in front of you and not anything else going on around you? And so that was where the basis of the story came from. But, you know, it is a difficult subject matter. We do use the phrase, what the fuck, once in the script. Mm-hmm. But other than that, there's no swearing in it. There's no nudity in it. There is some telling a story about her stepdad putting her in the shower because she never wants to use soap and never wants to shower. So it has this implied abuse, but it doesn't really show anything or talk about it. It just says, you know, I never wanted to shower and never wanted to use soap, and I don't understand why people would ever want to use soap, and my mom would get so mad and just throw me in the shower. But it's like told from the point of view of the individual. So, you know, for us, we're thinking, yeah, I could see why the mom would get really mad if this girl didn't shower for 3 weeks until you finally throw her in the shower and say, God damn it, take a shower. But then you can also see from the girl's point of view how abusive it is to have to put a teenage girl in the shower because she doesn't shower. And so it's like, it's difficult, but it's real. After we had it in London, people would come up to us after the show and say, you know, we had a friend whose daughter was like that, and we thought their daughter was just really unmanageable and really difficult. And they said, oh no, she's just special. We realized that this now that I've seen your play, that this is what she has. And now I understand that there was nothing those parents could have done to change what was wrong with her brain. Like, no amount of medication or therapy was ever going to make it better.
Mm-hmm.
And the interesting thing is, they're not special because they all behave the same. Like, it's cookie cutter. Like, it's different to us, like, because it's so unusual and weird the way they act and the way they view the world is so different from the way the rest of us do. But they all collectively think and act the same because it's all the prefrontal cortex that isn't functioning. So it's kind of interesting, because if you meet other people with fetal alcohol syndrome, they're all the same.
Mm-hmm. I see what you mean.
Which makes it interesting. Yeah, which makes it interesting.
Yeah. So has Tasha seen the show?
She has. She came to our preview night, and she was actually there for the awards night when we got the award for it. So she feels very proud that I took little snippets of her life and wove it in, because she's like, oh, I remember that conversation where we were trying to like count, and I thought it was some kind of trick you were trying to get me to do math. So, because yeah, it's true. I was always trying to get her to learn math, but
aren't we all?
I'm tricky that way. I'm tricky. Yes, I'll make you count your bus change. I'm not going to count it for you. So, but yeah, so I thought she would be really upset to see it, but she's actually quite proud of it. And she, you know, talks to people about it. And we had a little clip on YouTube about it, so she would share that with people.
No, that's good. Charlotte was doing really well with this. As you mentioned, she won an award for Best Actress, was it?
She did, yes. Now, she's from Sussex, New Brunswick, and yeah, then went away for college to study theater arts, and then started getting jobs on stage here in London, Ontario, and that's how I met Charlotte.
Probably one of her first opportunities to perform in St. John as well.
Very lucky to have her as an actress, and since she won that award, all these other directors in town are snatching her up, so I'm very lucky she can even carve out some time for me, because I have another play that I'm working on, and I wanted her to be in it, and now, like, I can't even, like, get her booked now.
Oh, no.
Because everybody's taking her for their plays, so.
Oh, geez. Do you find that when you're writing, your personality kind of starts changing when you're focusing on such different ideas?
No, because I'm a comedy writer. So what happens is I just infuse my comedy into the script. Mm-hmm. So when I wrote Wicked Fountain of Youth, even though it's like a more serious subject matter, I try to let my comedy come through, because you don't want the audience leaving terribly depressed. Like, you need to show the lighter moments. You need to show how funny some things are, trying to have an intellectual conversation with someone who doesn't see the world the same way you see the world. So you have to kind of show those lighter moments, because you don't want people being like super depressed when they leave. They want them to say, well, that was a heavy subject matter, yeah, but it was handled well.
Okay.
You know, and that's something that the critics said that we did well, is we tried to keep it, like, show the innocence of the girl, that this isn't her fault that she is this way, and try to show that side as well. And so I like comedy writing, so obviously my next one is going back to a comedy as well.
Definitely looking forward to seeing Wicked Fountain of Youth. Now, is there anything, like, I have a cat. I have two cats. Do you have two cats?
I do not have two cats.
Yeah. Do you have one cat?
I have a dog.
Oh. All right.
I read online, Ministry of Education did a survey of their high school students to see how many high school students had already started drinking. Now, mind you, high school students are not of drinking age.
Yeah.
Yet.
No, that's true. That's
and it was as high as 75%
yeah.
already started drinking, and they weren't even of legal age. So how do you get the message out to kids who aren't even legal age? Because sometimes you go into the beer store and it might be a little poster, a little thing there, like, don't drink beer when you're pregnant. But what if you're not even getting your liquor from the liquor store? You're getting it from your older brother who goes to get it for you, or you're buying it out of the trunk of somebody's car or whatever. Like, you know, how do you get the message out? How do you reach these people? Like, I would love to be able to do a partnership with, you know, the Minister of Education and the Minister of Health in New Brunswick, and say, let's do, and I know there are two different silos of the government with two different budgets, but if you could combine the efforts of both and maybe get the public health unit involved, imagine what you could do if you brought this show, this play, around all the different high schools in New Brunswick. If we brought it out to the Indian reservations, you know, and that's not to be racist. I mean, I'm like the great granddaughter of an Indian chief of the Minas Basin, and I know that we have a drinking problem.
Well,
and the other half of me is Irish, which is probably even worse.
I don't know. I don't know anything about anything, but I do know that your product, your show is definitely something that is long overdue in a lot of communities that I've been in, and we're going to welcome it, and we're looking forward to it.
Well, if anyone out there knows the premier, they'd like to invite him to the show, I'll give him a free comp.
Okay. Yeah.
Or the Minister of Health or the Minister of Education.
You know, 6 degrees of separation in New Brunswick.
I know.
We
I know. And I will comp them. They can come see the show, and they can work with me and Charlotte, and we will develop a program that they can take to all the high schools. We'd be happy to do that with you.
In New Brunswick, we can whittle down the 6 degrees of separation to 2. So we're going to be able to, we'll get that message out to them.
The premier's of the land, so that makes them like, my second cousin or third cousin, right?
That's right. Bring them up. Facebook them.
So, hey cousin, come out to my show.
Hey cuz, been a long time.
I'll help you out with a big social problem in New Brunswick.
Great.
That was Veronica Steele and her show, The Wicked Fountain of Youth, featuring Charlotte Weeks, winner of the 2017 London One Act Festival, Critics' Choice, and Best Actress. The Wicked Fountain of Youth will be performed at the Olin Theatre in the New Brunswick Museum. Get your pens, yes, pens, ready to write down these ticket sales codes. 25% off pre-sale code, which expires midnight of the 20th, just before the Fundy Fringe Festival starts, is Hot Ticket. Half Price Students, which never expires, is Fiverr. For 20% off their Tuesday show, TMI Tues, T-U-E-S. And for 20% off their Wednesday show, WTF Wed, W-E-D. Thanks again to the Wicked Fountain of Youth team for this amazing and unique gift for ticket deals.
Oh, serious. I need to get some sleep. Sally, Deadpool 3, and Angus are not acclimatizing to each other. Chasing and yowling, keeping me up all night. They destroyed almost everything. They got into my dulse, knocked down my collection of Batmobiles off the mantelpiece, and they tore up my inventory of feather boas. Hey, I'm a theater person. I need an inventory of feather boas. Okay, back to our next guest. Via Fringe Phone is Phil Rickaby. I was actually on Phil's stage-worthy podcast a while back, so I'm very excited to reciprocate and have him on Fringe Power. Phil comes to the Fundy Fringe with his show, The Commandment.
Phil.
Yes.
So you're traveling. You've been to St. John before, correct?
Yes, I have.
Okay. Now, were you...
Yeah.
Were you born here originally?
Oh, no, I just have friends there.
Oh, okay. No, that's great.
I'm an Ontario boy. I was born in Ontario. Yeah.
Oh, Upper Canada. Yes. You're coming down to see us. Well, no.
Yeah.
I know a lot of people are excited. I know we have some mutual friends, and there is a buzz about you coming. So that's going to be really, really
fun. Well, that's good. Good to hear.
Yeah. So tell us a little bit about your show.
So the show is called The Commandment, and the short pitch is it's about an atheist who finds out that he's been chosen to deliver God's new commandment.
Wow. That's a great pitch. That's a great short pitch. And and you're performing in this one. You wrote it and you're performing.
It's just me. Yeah, it's just me. It's a solo show.
You've shopped this around before, or is this going to be a premiere?
I performed this about summers ago at the Hamilton Fringe.
Okay, and good responses, I take it?
Yeah.
Okay, well, congratulations.
Great responses. Yeah, the interesting thing, and the thing that I didn't quite know that performing solo would do, is that it would be addicting, and that I would want to do and create more. So I have other ideas for solo shows in the future.
So when you say you were surprised at this, I take it this, I'll edit that, I'll try a different word. Your dabbling in the theater arts consisted of mostly writing before? You never performed?
I did perform. I just didn't know that solo performing.
Oh, solo
would
performing.
Be quite so addictive.
Yes, of course.
The Commandment is my first solo play, and I had not known before that it was how affecting it would be and how much it would really the idea of be like, it's all you and you're the one that's taking an audience on a journey. And that was really, there's sort of like a power in that. And that was really sort of addicting.
I find,
I just knew after I'd done it that I just wanted more.
I find solo shows really enjoyable because they're portable, and and you can really and you can really focus on them because really you can be the only diva that has to be dealt with during the show, right?
Yeah. I don't like to be a diva during the show. I try to keep my divaness to a minimum. I may occasionally dabble in divaness now and then.
Okay, so the commandment, is this a Valentine to atheists?
You know, interestingly, the premise is really just a jumping off point, and it's sort of an examination of what happens when somebody in a bad place, sort of like who's in an emotionally bad place, finds himself falling even further. Because one of the ideas is that that as a when you're given a commandment, you have to tell people. Like, you don't have a choice.
Yeah.
It's you're going to tell people whenever they're around. And so there's a resentment that builds in him because, number one, he never believed in God, doesn't want to believe in God, but now he knows that God's real. So it's like this downward spiral. And there's some other stuff, too, that's behind it that is really why he's damaged goods when the play starts. There's a lot of funny shit in there. So it's not like him in a bad place. I often find that the funniest things, like if somebody's in a really bad place, you can go further with the comedy than if somebody's like feeling really good about themselves.
Sure.
I think people who are down, it's funnier to take them.
No, I think that's true. That's why that's why we love those goofy the goofy cartoons, the goofy movies, because
absolutely, yeah.
Because I think that was their first rule in writing at Disney was make the character lower than anyone else on the planet, and that'll make it funny.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, well, hey, you know, my life's bad, but at least I'm not as bad as this guy. So it's not necessarily it's not anti-religion, it's not anti-atheism, it's just an examination of the character's comeuppance, I guess.
Yeah, it's really his journey. His journey into without giving too much away, his journey from feeling powerless to at least coming to terms with where he is in the world. It's not pro atheist, it's not anti religion, it just is.
Okay. No, that's fair enough. Fair enough. Good. Now, what's the age range for a suggested audience in the commandment?
I would call this PG, with the caveat that there's some strong language.
Okay.
So there's a few F bombs and things like that, but there's no mature themes really, other than, you know, thinking about religion in certain ways, but it's not. It's aside from some language, there's no mature content.
Okay. Did you come from a strong religious background growing up?
I did actually. When I was growing up, our family was very very fundamentalist, I think that in writing play, in addition to dealing with some others, I was also thinking a lot about my own journey from fundamentalism to agnosticism. I went from being very religious to having a lot of questions.
You got good reviews from the family?
Yes, the family's in the show. I did get good reviews from the family. I got good reviews from most of you. In fact, one of my first performances, there was a priest who came to the show and he sat in the front row.
Priests? He had priests. That's a good old
I only found out he was a priest afterwards.
Or can you say that good
old? I mean, he sat in the front row and it was really good. I mean, he'd said that he'd considered coming in his collar.
Mm-hmm.
Because I don't know, he was like, that'll intimidate this atheist guy.
Yeah,
but I would have loved that.
Priests are all about intimidating.
At the end of the show, he really Like, he was like, I want my entire congregation coming to this show.
Oh. Well, heck, yeah, put that up on the on the Sunday bulletin.
Yeah.
Yeah, no.
There you go.
That's a great idea. That's a great idea. And you still have...
absolutely.
You're still having time to do your own podcast, right? You still have your theater podcast going on, right?
I am.
Stage-worthy.
I still have the theater podcast stage-worthy. I've got some episodes for people who are at the Sunday Fringe. We'll be doing the Fringe Roundup, which is a roundtable discussion on the Saturday of Fringe. And we'll record that, and then it'll be up within an hour and a half to make it as up to the minute as possible. There's just going to be some of the Fringe artists from the Fundy Fringe talking about their shows, what they've seen in Fringe and their Fringe experience. So it should be really fun.
So the Commandment, would you dare to say that it's slightly biographical?
Only buried very deeply is anything autobiographical in there. There's very little. It is not one of those personal stories, although there's inspired by personal events, but they're buried very deeply. I mean, it's not autobiographical because, you know, I've never met one, and I've never been charged with delivering his new commandments. So, very deep inside there are some very personal stories.
Okay. So, excuse me. I keep thinking I'm hearing a cat in the room. I don't know what's going on. There's like some scratching. Like there's seriously some heavy scratching going on, and that is really bizarre. There it is. Okay.
Hmm.
That's not coming from you, is it? It's no cat on your end.
Maybe it's a raccoon. Nope. No cat on my end. Maybe it's a raccoon.
Oh gosh. Well, I wouldn't be surprised. It's not heavily biographical due to the fact that you haven't met God, actually. So let's say you did meet a divine entity, a creator that was in command of reality. Do you think God would like your show? Would God like your show?
Do I think God would like my show? I do. I actually do think that God would like my show. I do, actually.
That's a great headline. God will like my show. Even God will like my show. I think
That's right. Even God will like the show. I really think that he would.
That's fantastic.
And he would write a review, and I'd be like, 5 stars. God is what we would put there.
And he would buy
on the poster.
And he would buy a Fringe T-shirt on the way out. And
absolutely. Of course, he would. Yeah.
No, that's absolutely hilarious.
For the commandment, I think I haven't talked enough about how funny it is, and it is a funny show. And I sometimes when we start talking about it in depth, I lose a little bit about talking about how funny it is, because it actually comes from a place of pain. But like you said, that's like the goofy effect. That's sort of a funny thing. I mean, the play starts off with the main character is telling us that that God gave him the commandment when he was in the toilet, in the men's room at work. Right. So it's an awkward spot to get that message, and it kind of goes from there.
Any bad feedback from people who might like? You got good feedback from the priest, which is amazing. But do you think anyone has the chance to walk away offended by it? I know there's always that potential.
I think if you were to, if somebody stays to the way they want to be offended, because there's a message that you'll find at the end of the play, and I think that regardless of what you believe, you will not be offended by it, and you will have feeling positive. I could see somebody deciding they were going to leave because they were offended early on, but if you stay to the end, you will find the message, and I think you'll be moved by it.
Perfect. And then, of course, with Stage Worthy Podcast, that's how many episodes do you have of that so far? That must be coming close to...
I just created the 141st episode.
Holy cow.
So we'll be adding, I think, by the end of the year, close to 200, I think.
It's still mostly Canadian performers on the show that you interview?
It's always going to be Canadians. It's never going to be... occasionally we're in Fringe for people who might be from outside of Canada, but when I sit down with people, my priority is to talk to Canadian voices.
Thanks for joining us, Phil.
The Commandment runs August 21st to 25th at the Sanctuary Theater, 228 Germain Street, and you can check out his theater podcast, Stage Worthy, right now at stageworthypodcast.com. But don't listen to my episode. Just don't. I was in a bad headspace. I was in a bad headspace at the time. My interview sucked. I was melancholy and tired and dark. I was not a good guest. So don't go and listen to the May 3rd, 2016 show at stageworthypodcast.com, or you'll just be overexposed to my pretentious and somewhat whiny musings, available for Apple and Google podcast apps.
This is Sarah Rankin, your friendly, fundy Fringe Festival director, and you're listening to Local 107.3.
St. John's Alternative Radio, Local 107.3 FM.
Hey everybody, it's Albert Einstein.
Hi, it's Frida Kahlo.
Hey, it's George Washington Carver.
Hello everybody, it's Seth Cooper.
And I'm Tim Trunell. This is Fringe Power. Urban Spine is a theater company traveling across the continent with their award-winning show, The Cardboard Countess. On the Fringe phone now is the creative and performance team, Victoria and Carson Goring. Hello, Victoria and Carson.
Hi.
Hey, how are you? Can you hear me?
Yes, I can. How are you?
I'm good. Thank you. Hey, everybody.
Hi.
Okay, so whom is who?
I'm Victoria.
I'm Carson.
Okay. Hey. Great. Thanks. Well, I appreciate you taking the time out to talk so that we can get a little bit of the lowdown on the Cardboard Countess. So you've just come from PEI.
That's right. We're still in PEI right now. We're leaving today.
Okay, and I think through our messaging, you told me that you had a great turnout. You had good responses.
Yeah, it was wonderful.
So that's great. So perfect. So you got good crowds. You got good responses. Was this your first time in the Maritimes doing the show?
It is, absolutely.
And so this will definitely be your first time in St. John, New Brunswick.
It absolutely will. Yeah.
Okay. So where are you two from?
We are from Los Angeles, California.
Okay. So both of you are?
Yeah.
Okay. And Carson, what's your last name?
Goring.
Oh, you're Carson Goring. So you're related?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
My mom.
What?
This is my mom.
Oh, okay. All right. Okay. So wait a second. You're related and you're doing a show together.
Yeah, we're a mom and daughter, and Carson is actually the star of the show, and she's 14, so I believe she's the youngest star of a Fringe show ever.
Holy cow. It just boggles my mind that you can, like, a mother and daughter, father, son, father, daughter, mother, son, you know, just anyone related, they'd be able to, like, I started theater in a lot of ways to get away from my family. But obviously you two have a good working relationship.
Yeah, definitely, yeah.
Okay, so whose idea was the Cardboard Countess then?
That was her idea. So she had an idea a long time ago, right? So for the idea of the Cardboard Countess, and then just last year started to have an idea of, like, how it could be, like, a play, and got, like, I guess, took the idea again, matured it, and yeah.
Okay, so you both had a hand in crafting the show.
Absolutely, yeah. And Carson wrote all that music and all the songs that are in the show.
Holy cow, you guys really are from L.A. No, that's awesome. How many shows are you doing in Canada? Have you managed to do so far?
Well, we did the Toronto Fringe Festival and the PEI, and then we were down in Maine for the Portland Fringe Festival. And then St. John will be our last Fringe Festival.
Oh, good. Okay, so that's your vacation. No Disneyland this year.
Yeah, exactly. Oh,
what's the Cardboard Countess about?
It's about these two characters. So there's Ever, who's 14. I play Ever, and she's
kind of in a bad place in her life. She feels kind of isolated in her community because, you know, she doesn't really have any friends. She's being bullied. She's different. She is a singer. She loves music, and that's all she wants to do. And she finds this lady who lives in this tiny little parquet. It's like a small town. There's a one tiny little parquet that's full of trash, and so she's made all the trash into a castle and a giant ballroom dress, and she says that she's a countess, and that all her citizens left her, and this is the last bit of her earldom. And so, obviously, at first, everything's like, she's crazy, and just laying in the park, but she loses her earbuds there, so she keeps coming back, and over time, they start to make friends because they're both kind of isolated in their community and they have kind of the same opinions and views, and so, you know, they kind of have a friendship, and at the end they both like save each other. So
okay, but it's a classic tale really in a lot of ways, right?
It is, yeah, it is, yeah. It's like a modern day fairy tale.
A weird fairy tale. Yeah.
I was thinking one of you may have been a director, writer, and the other one was, but you know what? There's a lot of hype about you guys coming anyway. So, I mean, it's awesome. Great. I mean,
well, we actually have, it's not just the two of us. So there's, we're both in the play. Carson's the star. We also have two local teenagers.
Yes.
Because, and we have to learn the part in like only a couple of rehearsals, so they have a really, really, really challenging role.
Yeah.
And it's not like a little background role. The teenagers are like really vital to all the action. So we have two local teenagers, and I'm pretty sure we're going to have live music. I'm just waiting to hear back from our musician. So yeah, I think St. John is going to be our best show ever, actually.
Oh, yeah. I remember seeing a post that you were looking for some extra actors on site. So,
yeah.
So do you know who these actors are at the moment? Or is it going to be a surprise to you?
Well, I have two teenagers, but I don't want to give you their names yet because I'm just waiting for them to, like, confirm.
Yeah, perfect.
Like,
I'm just, no, that's great. No, that'll be a nice surprise. That'll be a nice surprise for locals. And so it must be a little stressful. Not knowing who these personalities are going to be included into your fold while you're here, but someone else is going to be managing your music as well.
Well, Adam's going to be adding, hopefully live to the Adam Washburn. So he's going to play like a character in the park as well, and he's going to like add to Carson's existing music, and then add some of his own original music as well.
Wow, it's almost like you and you're confident you're going to be able to do this all within what, a day to rehearse and pull it all together.
Yeah. We come in early. We have we have about 4 or 5 days before the Fringe starts. And we've done this several times. So
5 days is plenty for us.
It is. Yeah. I can do it 3. Yeah. So we're really used to it. The teenager characters, we like, they have the scenarios. They get to create their own characters. And then within the scenario, we improvise it. And then we pick, you know, the things that work best. So every single Fringe is different, which is really cool because it's good for us too, because they always come up with new and creative things. So it's cool. It keeps this show like always fresh and different.
That's really neat. So you guys are you're a creative family all the time.
Yeah.
Okay.
Pretty much. Yeah.
Is this your first show kind of together, both of you as a mother and daughter team?
No, Dylan Game.
Oh, well, we didn't do the Dylan Game.
So we had our sword show. Yeah.
Oh. We have a kids show that we do in like libraries and museums and fairs and stuff. And it's a shorter show and it's a lot sillier. It's a sword fighting show. So it's a really fun show. So we haven't done it in the Maritimes, but in Ontario we did the Dylan Games in a bunch of libraries, and it's a really fun sword fighting show. So that show we have done a lot.
Yeah.
It's 100% different from the cover Countess because
it's the opposite. Yeah.
Yeah, it's really silly and goofy and physical. Although the cover Countess is also physical, but it's a lot more comedic.
You're traveling together. You're working together. Do you recognize when you're being too much of a family member, especially in moments when you're kind of maybe getting on the other's nerves, and you can separate? Can you separate family member from working peer, or do you just muddle through it?
I think I can separate pretty well. It's like,
Like, I work with my director and actress, and then I go home with my mom. It's like, kind of,
yeah.
Because I mean, I feel like every actress, like, you know, their acting mode and then, like, their home mode. So I feel like they're kind of. You know,
I think it's because of schedules, right? Like,
yeah.
Because rehearsal is scheduled. So we just.
It's like, when we go to rehearsal, we're in this mode, then we go home, then we're in this mode.
Yeah.
Okay. No, that's. I'm envious.
It's nice being with somebody that you know so well on stage because you can, like, you know, a lot of things that it's hard to work for in theater, like trust and listening and understanding. It's already there,
you've got, like, the level of trust, which makes it easy. Honestly, it was the hardest part was, like, learning to not trust each other. Like, we never met each other before.
Right, to pretend to be strangers.
Yeah, that level of trust is very nice to have on stage.
Okay, because that's exactly what my parents and I don't have. That's why my parents and I will never be in a show together, I'm sure. I just can't imagine. No, that's really impressive. I've got a couple projects that I thought, hey, it'd be nice to have someone that I really knew. But then you're worried that that's going to rip apart the relationship or something, or someone's going to storm off, like...
Yeah, that can happen. I've had that happen in the past with creative things that sometimes, it's like a roommate, you know? It's sometimes easier to be a roommate with a complete stranger because then you're respectful of each other. Whereas if your roommate's with a friend, then you just, like, borrow each other's stuff and you're not as respectful. So that definitely happens a lot.
So are there other people in the family you collaborate with, or are you two the Wunderkinds?
No, just the two of us.
Okay. No, that's really good. So, the Cardboard Countess, and I've been asking this of everybody, because the Fringe, as we know, is there's something for everybody. So, is the Cardboard Countess accessible for families? Is it a family show, in a way?
It's definitely for teenagers.
Yeah. It depends on the family, I guess. But
there are kind of, like, some more serious issues, so, like, I would say ages 10 and up. I mean, kids would probably still like it.
Yeah, I mean, there are some parts of it that I'm sure kids would love. Like, kids have loved it too, and I think when I was 10, I would have loved the show. But there are definitely some more serious issues. And there's, like, some brief, like, profanity. Nothing too bad.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, we've heard shows way more.
We do have a little bit of profanity.
Yeah.
A little bit of profanity. Okay.
Depends how old your kids are, but if teenagers, it's perfect for teenagers, adults, and this, I think, like, maybe 11 and up.
11 and up, okay.
11 and up? Okay. No, that's fair. That's good to know. What else is it about the show that you think makes it so successful for the responses that you've gotten?
I think it's because it has, it kind of has something for everybody. Like, the Countess speaks, like, in really sort of, like, heightened Elizabethan language. So she's a little bit like a Shakespeare character. So I think some people, like, really love the wordplay. Of course, because, like, there's so much action with the teenagers, and, like, the energy of young people is, like, wonderful on stage because, like we cast young people as young people, so we don't have adults pretending to be young people. And I think that makes a difference because you're actually, like, experiencing, like, how young people actually are. The music, there's just so many themes, you know, about, like, taking care of the earth and, of course, like, the whole trash. And then just, like, on, like, a technical note, like, we've seen a lot of wonderful shows. All the shows in the PR are really interesting. Our show's a little bit different because, like, it goes from beginning to end with no... It's, like, continuous, like, there's no blackouts. It's, like, continuous action, and it's kind of linear. We're seeing a lot of shows that are, like, deconstructed as a storyline, which is very cool, but I think when you have, like, a story that just, like, keeps going, and it's the characters actually experiencing those moments in that time.
It makes it easier to follow the journey for the audience.
I think so.
Yeah. So, just, like, for this show especially, like, it's easier to follow, like, the storyline, like, the journey of the characters. So, I personally like that. I always love seeing the journey.
Yeah.
It's a very balanced show as well. I feel that it has, because it is a dramatic show, but it also has elements of comedy, and it has, you know, lightheartedness.
That's true.
And it's got, like, some charm for you. It's got, like, you know, some, like, deep emotional stuff for me. It's
There's a lot of emotion. Yeah. Like, yeah. There's like it's sadness and laughter.
It's a real show, yeah.
There's a lot of emotion in the show for sure.
Yeah, but it's a nice balance, I think.
That's cool. So, in a way, your difference is that you've brought it back to the original roots of storytelling. It's not, yeah, it's pure emotionally driven story, beginning to end. Yeah. It, okay. No, that's cool. So, well, if you
found out, yeah.
What? Yeah. Yeah. Of course. So, what do you guys do for to relax then? If you spend so much time together working on theater projects.
Well, traveling is fun.
Yeah, we love going off in nature, relaxing, and, like, hiking, going to cool new places. And, you know, it's just, like, sometimes it's nice, like, working to be a tourist, you know?
Yeah.
That's always fun, because it's, like, you know, being actor and tourist, it's, like, fun to find the balance. And
yeah, the traveling has been really fun, going to all these places we've never been to before. Swimming,
yeah.
Like we got to go to the beaches yesterday and DI,
nice.
Super fun.
We got given a tour. Our actors took us around and took us to all the
nice.
Local places. So that was awesome. So we get to see stuff that we wouldn't normally know.
Yeah, we'd just be like, oh, tourists go to all the tourist places, but we get to see like other cool stuff we wouldn't know about. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
You basically relax when the show's not happening, but you're working pretty much all the time, aren't you?
This trip, yeah. It's sometimes just having a nap to relax.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, there'll be a lot of neat touristy things that the locals will be able to show you here. That's for sure. We're looking forward to having you here and being able to enjoy your show, The Cardboard Countess. Was there anything else you needed, like maybe like chair or something, like a prop or something you need sourced here, or are you traveling with everything that you have that you need?
No, we got everything. Probably
everything. Yeah.
Oh, you drove up here?
Yeah.
Jeez, holy cow! I'm envious as well. You drove across the continent. That's awesome. Well, that's a wonderful product to be able to create out of such a relationship between you two. I'm sure it's going to be really really special. So I will let you get back to the red sand before you have to leave.
Well, we're really looking forward to going to St. John.
Yeah.
I'm so excited. It seems like the nicest, most well organized, just friendliest French festival. I think of like. All of them.
Yeah, no, we try. You know, we're working hard. Our sixth year, so we're getting into a groove, and we really appreciate people coming in and enjoying the city and our Fringe Festival. That's it's really special to us. So you should be in for a good time. You will be in for a good time. Great. All right. Well, thank you very much for taking the time out, Victoria and Carson.
Oh, thank you.
Great. All right, and we'll see you soon at the Fundy Fringe Festival.
Okay.
Hey, bye. Thank you, Victoria and Carson. The Cardboard Countess goes up August 21st to the 25th at the Sanctuary Theater during the 2018 Fundy Fringe Festival. Follow more of Victoria and Carson's story about them and their travels on Facebook. Make sure to seek out all of our guests and their shows on social media, especially noting the performance times. Keep that pen handy.
Oh, God.
Okay. Thanks for listening to Fringe Power. Join us next time for more interviews with Fundy Fringe performers. Okay. I have to go get a nap in right meow. Thanks to the Fundy Fringe Festival and Local 107.3 FM for their support. Also, thanks to our guests today. And be sure to find their venues and performance times online. You can connect to the Fundy Fringe through social media, Facebook, Twitter, and of course, www.fundyfringefestival.com. We try to post as much information as we can through Fringe Power's Facebook, but please get out there and connect. Thanks for listening. See you next time.